Om Sahana Bhavatu Sahana Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavai Tejasvinavaditamastu Mavidvishavai Om Shanti 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 Harihi Om. Om, may Brahman protect us both. May Brahman bestow upon us both the fruit of knowledge. May we both obtain the energy to acquire knowledge. May what we both study reveal the truth. May we cherish no ill feeling toward each other. Om, peace, peace, peace be unto all. Om Jananim Sharadam Devim Ramakrishnam Jagat Gurum Pada Padme Tayo Shritva Pranamami Muhur Muhu Om Sthapakaya Chadharmasya Sarva Dharma Swarupine Avatara Varishthaya Ramakrishnaya Te Namaha. So, in our last class, we discussed some very important points. If we do not understand these few points, it would be difficult to understand Sri Ramakrishna's relationship with everybody, not only his relationships at Kamarpur, but also his relationships throughout his life. I'll give an example also. First of all, almost unaware of his body consciousness, Sri Ramakrishna's awareness of body, that I am the body, was so minimal, the slightest thing would throw him into ecstasy by seeing any beautiful object or by hearing a beautiful song or even a simple thought comes into his mind. Instantaneously, he will forget his body. Our whole problem is, even when we sit for meditation, we are not able to forget our body. Now, this is also very important because without understanding this, it is possible to impute so many wrong things to Sri Ramakrishna's life. Here we are going to discuss Ramakrishna's relationships, especially with some of the women in the Kamarpukur village. That is why the whole subject has come up. If he is full of body consciousness, what would have happened? His relationship with women would be like any other, a young man and a young woman. And they would instantaneously feel that they are also women, then the relationship would be a totally different relationship. Now we have to understand one more point. If we are fortunate to come across any person whose body consciousness is very minimal or absent, you know what would be the reaction? In our own awareness, we would be less aware of the body. I'll give you some few examples which are very wonderful. Supposing there is a artist, a singer or a player. And who is the greatest player or singer? If you analyze, you will understand one thing clearly. That person who becomes least aware of himself or herself, that person would be the greatest singer, the greatest actor, the greatest player, etc. Is it not? Now, such a person would be able to express his speciality, art, deeper than anybody else, better than anybody else. Now, if you are also a lover of that particular art, whoever is performing better, you will forget your own body consciousness. That is what you call it. I am so absorbed, I forgot time, space, etc. Forgetting time, space is equivalent to forgetting one's own personality, body and mind. And Sri Ramakrishna was a past master in it. When he was talking to, say, the village women or men, what would you think with this understanding? Not only they would not remember that they are bodies, but on the contrary, they would be more absorbed in what he is doing it. This is a wonderful subject. Even in our ordinary time, if someone is singing so beautifully, the person will not be able to sing unless the person forgets that I am a good singer, everybody is impressed with me, then you will be aware that that person is very aware of his singing and it won't be perfect. Both ways it works. Both ways means what? When a person is too much body conscious, then he reminds the other persons also their own body consciousness and vice versa. It will happen. This is the first point we discussed, giving the examples of Shukadeva, etc. Second point, that his overwhelming love. This word overwhelming love, not my words, Swami Sharadananda's words, overwhelming love. Whatever Sri Ramakrishna loved, he loved to the greatest extent. Overwhelming love. Whether it is to his bosom friend Gaya Vishnu, his father, his mother, villagers. And when he came to Dakshineswar, I am extending our study further, how did he love his own future disciple? His disciples could be, rather I would say this, whoever came into contact with Sri Ramakrishna, all of them could be divided into three classes. Monastic disciples, householder disciples, and anybody else who just came with to him. Say, for example, Keshav Chandra Sen, Shivanath Shastri. How did Sri Ramakrishna love these people? Sri Ramakrishna crystal clearly knew Keshav Chandra Sen was never going to be neither his disciple nor was he going to accept his ideas in toto. And Vijay Krishna Goswami, he knew that he loved him, but he said, you are not my disciple. But at the same time, how much did he love Vijay Krishna Goswami? How much did he love Keshav Chandra Sen? Do you remember? He said, when he died, I could not get up from my bed for 3 days. This is only an example. What about his love for, say, Rani Rasmani, Mathur Babu, and so many other people, not to speak of the direct disciples. One important point we have to understand. Did Sri Ramakrishna love somebody more, or did he love all of them equally? It's very important for us to understand. He loved everybody equally. But outside, his behavior seemed to some people that he loved some people more than the other people. That was because he had to put extra effort, extra time to make them his own. For example, Narendra. Why was he loving Narendra so much? Narendra, you eat this, Narendra, you eat that. Not because he loved other people less. Other people already became his. Narendranath was not willing. Why was he not willing? I can give you a few reasons. One reason was the orientation of his mind was not towards anything personal. Purely towards the impersonal. The another reason is, he was specially brought by Sri Ramakrishna from that Saptarshi Mandala. For what purpose? To uplift the world. And here is an important point. Can anyone do any good to anything, anybody, unless the first condition is fulfilled? What is the first condition? One has to first love. If Narendranath had not loved the world, then he would not have done much good. Because if you don't have love to anybody, you cannot continue doing good. This is the simple psychological fact. Sri Ramakrishna was trying to bring his mind to that level where he could love the whole world. And how could he love the whole world? What is another name for the whole world? The Divine Mother. Also, there are so many points, you know. As you meditate, or as I meditate, so many meanings come to me. And Swamiji had to go through so many difficulties, so much of heartbreak. Swamiji was betrayed by his own disciples. One is here in England, Miss Muller, E.T. Sturdy, and in America, is Kripananda, and so many others. They have right and left, they have betrayed. Swamiji loved, and he loved also as a person. Naturally, he got so many blows. That's why Sri Ramakrishna warned him, why do you bring all these Tarachok and all those fellows along with you? Meaning, you have to be discriminative. But he was so great, Sri Ramakrishna used to discriminate. And then, bestow. Love is different. But what Swamiji said, if I don't help them, who else is going to help them? miserable people in the world, but he had to pay heavy price. Anyway, I will not go into the details, but what is important, Sri Ramakrishna had spent more time with Narendra and to make him his own, so that he could be the chief instrument for helping the world. Sri Ramakrishna had brought an unmanageable power, but he had to make that power useful, malleable, and for that he paid the price, heavy price. Whereas the other fellows, they didn't have that much power, and they surrendered to himself on the very first sight. Whereas Narendra was not a person like that. That is why Sri Ramakrishna had to show extra love. But that doesn't mean that he loved Narendra more and he loved other disciples any less. Because they were small vessels. How much time it takes to fill up their heart? This is the truth. So this is a very important point. Sri Ramakrishna, his love is overwhelming love. He loved everybody. In this regard, one more point we need to clarify. There were some people whom Sri Ramakrishna used to recognize as hypocrites. Hypocrites. And he used to make fun of them, you know, so that the others would know and they cannot ask why are you making fun of us. Because he will tell, because in your heart you are thinking like this. And they could not deny it. If you ask somebody you are a hypocrite, then they will get angry with you because you cannot prove. But when he says, they know in their hearts that they are hypocrites, and Sri Ramakrishna knows it, and they have no power to retort. Very intelligent person, you know. But did he love them or not? Because what he loved was not the body, was not the mind. What he loved was that which is behind the body, mind, shining, the pure Atma. Then why did he not pay attention to these hypocrites? Because they were not ready to receive his love. This word is beautiful word, overwhelming love. Overwhelming means he will overwhelm anybody so that person will get benefit. And here is also very interesting word, but I will include it in the third category. So Ramakrishna was emotionally mature. Emotional maturity means what? You have the emotion, but you are mature enough not to be overwhelmed by it. Even when you are overwhelmed by it, you know that your character, your behavior will not change. The example given, when you are watching a drama, a movie, or reading a book, a novel. So, you know, some of us, tears come to our... Even when you are there, that can affect our character. Watching a movie, people can shed tears. And when they see some pathetic scene, then again tears will come. But that is not enjoying, having emotional maturity. It's emotional immaturity. Because even good things also would overwhelm them. That means very, very quickly they will be subject to somebody's manipulation. All that they need to do is, oh, you are wonderful, you are beautiful, and you are marvelous, and they are done. Afterwards, they have to pay heavy price for that. Whereas Sri Ramakrishna, he is not to be taken in by that. He could lose his entire personality, experience any bhava, but at the same time, he was a master of emotion. This is called emotional maturity. In short, what is emotional maturity? You experience any type of emotion to any degree that you want. But at the same time, you are the master. That is called emotional maturity. That means what can bring this about? Only knowledge associated with emotion alone can bring this. Whereas, for us, the knowledge follows our emotion. Whereas for them, the emotion follows the knowledge. That is the greatest difference. And how do we know this? It is such a fascinating subject. In our last class, we discussed this. Practically, absence of the body consciousness. Then overwhelming love, emotional maturity. One point I mentioned, but we did not discuss. That is, extraordinary power of Viveka, Vairagya and detachment. Sri Ramakrishna had these three qualities. Viveka means what? Discrimination means what? Watch everything and come to the kernel of the truth. That is called discrimination. And what is vairagya? Dispassion. What is dispassion? There is a special definition of what is vairagya. What is it? After viveka. Viveka means what? Discrimination. This is right and this is not right. To give up what is not right and to follow what is right, that is called dispassion. And nothing to do, you go to Rishikesh or Himalayas and then you weep for some time. What is called smashana vairagya and like that so many, what is called job losing vairagya. You won't last long. So this is complete, not this is right and follow the right. And this is wrong, give up the wrong. That is why Sri Ramakrishna, he discriminated this. Taka Mati, the moment he said Mati, is this taka is of same value. Very interesting words, you know. I am going on, but it is very necessary. When he said money, coin, rupee coin is equivalent to clay, and clay is equivalent to rupee coin. In what sense he was saying that both are of the same value? Was he telling that is mud the same value as a rupee coin? From a worldly point of view, there is a heaven and hell difference. But from a spiritual point of view, there is absolutely no difference. Means what? If you are attached to mud, it is not going to take you to God. Equally, if you are attached to valuable things, money, etc., money, house, etc., that is also not going to take you to God. Not only that, which is greater obstacle in spiritual progress? Something of less value or something of more value?
Something of more value.
So again, I have to quote Swami Dayananda. Sometimes extraordinarily beautiful expressions. A value is a value only when you value it. If you don't, a small baby doesn't value gold. You give it a doll or a chocolate, teddy bear, and very happy. And you give some diamond necklace. What is the child going to do with it? This is important to know that whatever we value in spiritual life, that may be our greatest obstruction from a worldly point of view. I'm not talking about Parama Purushartha, not that Purushartha value. Purushartha also means, you know, values, supreme values, according to Hinduism, Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. I'm not talking about them. So Sri Ramakrishna's Vairagya means that he is not talking from a worldly point of view. There are some things which will give you lot of advantages. From a spiritual point of view, the more that you value an object, the stronger, the harder it is for you to give up if you want to progress towards God. Without understanding this, simply say Ramakrishna said rupee is coin, coin is rupee. But here, what is the point we are discussing? The moment he discriminated, thus his vairagya, his dispassion, means passion is totally gone. That means throughout his life, if somebody says, I will give you some money, he never cared for it. So he said in the Lila Prasanga, Mathur Babu had not become devoted to Sri Ramakrishna just like that. He tested Sri Ramakrishna. How many ways? Three ways. What was the first one? He tempted him with sex. You know, he brought the woman. He took also Sri Ramakrishna to prostitutes' places and he also brought a very interesting episode, you know. Sri Ramakrishna was later describing, Mathur Babu brought one lady called Lakshmi Bai. And what was his remark about her? She was a very beautiful lady. Suppose Mathur Babu had brought an ugly hag. You think Sri Ramakrishna would be? This ugly, who wants ugly? But the thing is, very interesting point is, Sri Ramakrishna, he was a God man. Was he unaware of the difference between a beautiful woman and an ordinary woman? He knows. A beautiful woman is a very beautiful woman. He knows. That means what? He was not devoid of discrimination. He has full discrimination is there. But at the same time, his mind did not go there. So that was the first test. What was the second test? Money. Yeah. He wanted to give him estate and all those things. See, Ramakrishna just felt, he said, I got so angry, I took an axe to a stick to break the head of Madhur Babu. Then Madhur Babu, you know, Shayana, he tried through his mother and he failed. These are the two tests. What was the third test? What was the third test? And that is the greatest test. You know what is that? So much honor, Madhur Babu, the owner of that entire Dakshineswar temple, who could dismiss anybody on the spot, he used to honor his Baba so much that one word from Sri Ramakrishna's mouth, it is like royal commandment. For 14 years, Madhur Babu served Sri Ramakrishna like that. Now, if anybody, a person who is in such power, if he shows any one of us a little bit of, even if that person smiles at you, it's a funny incident, you know. Swamiji shook hands with one of the ladies. She said, for 3 days, I could not wash that hand because that of holiness. But this is entirely different. What is the point I am saying? If any publicly honored person honors us, how much of egotism it brings to us. That is why Sri Ramakrishna could never tolerate being addressed as either Baba or Karta or Guru. Because the moment you say, you are my Gurudev, then I feel, yes, there is somebody who is honoring me by calling me a Gurudev. Sometimes they mispronounce also. 3 tests. Sri Ramakrishna passed all the 3 tests with flying colors. And that is why Madhur Babu now knows he cannot be anybody else other than God. Such a wonderful life. Now with that, what are we talking about? The 4th great qualification of Sri Ramakrishna, Viveka, Vairagya. What is the last one? Detachment. Detached. Sri Ramakrishna is another name for detachment. What is detachment? It is mainly, it is a mental, spiritual quality. But outside also, the moment a person comes to know that this is not good for me, and he will, even if that person is very dear, very near, whatever happens, he will say that I am not affected. So what is detachment? The quality of not being affected in any way, even if most overwhelming things come. And that in that connection only I was telling you about Ramachandra. Mukham Bujeshri Mangala Manjula Pratha. When the news came that you are going to be coronated as a prince, it did not break into Prasannatam Nagataya. It did not become very happy after hearing the news. And Tathana Mamle, the same way, it has not become small and black and cloudy, hearing that he was not only going to be coronated, he is going to be sent out for 14 years in Vanavas Dukkataha. He knew what is the difficulty that he is going to face. That means absolutely it will remain in this way. That is what Bhagavad Gita is telling. Dukkheshu anudvignamanaha sukheshu vigatasprihaha vita raga bhaya krodhaha sthitadhihi munihi ucchate. That is overwhelming suffering, grief, overwhelming joy. Under both these circumstances, the mind of a sthita prajna, it remains absolutely the same. But never ever mistake, I am bringing that point again and again. Not that they will not experience them. They will experience. If it is good news, they are happy. If it is bad news, they will be unhappy. But that news will remain only as news. They are masters of their emotion. That is called emotional maturity. Sri Ramakrishna from the very beginning, the moment he comes to know this is not good, instantaneous detachment to that. Yes, that quality is there. Just I am giving you one simple example. he used to love Narendra. And Narendra one day asked him, are you not going to become like Jadabharata? What happened, do you know?
He started doubting.
No.
Dear.
No. He got confused. So he ran to the Divine Mother. And he was asking, Mother, why do I love Narendra so much? And he came back with the answer. What was the answer? I love you because I see Narayana in you. The moment I don't see Narayana in you, I will be able to bear even to see your face. What are the other people thinking? Some of the people.
Yeah.
So he loves Narendra too much. What is their idea of Narendra? What was their idea of Narendra? Means he is a very talented young man, really. They know that this very interesting point. The moment Narendra Surya came into their midst, they knew what was his greatness. He was a very intelligent person, extraordinarily capable of absorbing himself in meditation, and he was talented. Sri Ramakrishna himself tells, even Keshav Chandra Sen is nothing. If Keshav Chandra Sen is some one petaled lotus or something, my Narendra is 1,000 petaled lotus. And Narendra knew about it. Sri Ramakrishna knew about it. Others also knew about it to some extent. So it is natural. Oh, he is such a great man among us. Therefore, it is natural for Sri Ramakrishna to love him. No, Sri Ramakrishna was not loving him because of any of these qualities. Only one quality. What is it? He was seeing God in him. More manifestation of God in Narendra than in anybody else. If this is the normal state of Sri Ramakrishna's mind, so whatever he looks at, what do you think he will be seeing? I'll bring another this subject also, another way. You know, Gopal Erma. First she had, her heart was filled only with the vision of Gopala. But when she came to Sri Ramakrishna, what was the thing that she was experiencing? Gopala was entering into Sri Ramakrishna, coming out to her, again entering. Many times he did that. What is the symbolism of that, significance of that event? He was making her clearly to realize that me and Sri Ramakrishna are not different. We are exactly the same. Inside, I am Gopala. Outside, I am Sri Ramakrishna. And because she addressed from that time onwards, until that time, for Gopala Erma, she was not Gopala Erma, she was Aghoramani Devi. Sri Ramakrishna was a great devotee of God. Very great devotee of God. But that after that moment, what did he become? My
Gopala.
That awe had gone. This is my Gopala. And since that time, she started addressing Sri Ramakrishna as Gopala. And so, he also started addressing her as Mother. That's why from the devotee's point, she came to be known as Gopala's Mother. Means Sri Ramakrishna's Mother. That was the first. And after a few days, what happened? This Gopala started entering into the main disciples of Sri Ramakrishna's. Gopala enters into Narendra's body, comes out, Rakan's body comes out, then other direct disciples. What was Gopala indicating? Not only Sri Ramakrishna is me, all these are nothing but Gopala, me. And then the culmination came on Rathupani Hati, Rathotsava. That day she went. You read that one? The great master. He said, that day I was about to raise Kurukshetra war. That means she was seeing the chariot which is made up of wood. The priests who were sitting on the chariot, the image of Radha Krishna in the chariot, the people who came to watch that festival, Gopala, what was Gopala doing? Entering into each one of them and coming out, indicating what? The whole universe is nothing but
Gopala.
Nothing but Gopala. From that day onwards, she was not merely Sri Ramakrishna's mother. She was Gopala Erma to everything. And then she used to address, everybody is Gopala, including Holy Mother. Holy Mother, Nivedita, everybody she would address as my Gopala. That is the ultimate point. So what is the point we are discussing now? See, Ramakrishna's vision after all this sadhanam, don't forget, when did all these disciples come to him?
After
his sadhana was over, he's considering all of them as nothing but pure Atma. The Vedantic word for that, Gopala or whatever you call it, Mother Kali, what? Atman. If you use Vedantic terminology, it is Atma. If you use Vaishnava terminology, it is seeing Krishna. If you use Shakta terminology, it is the Divine Mother Kali. That is what he meant, I see Narayana. But what is the point here? That even when he was at Kamalapur, he was looking upon everybody in from the heightened state of spiritual experience, which is behind everybody. There is the same Atma. Why is it necessary for us to understand? Because without that vision, to love anything overwhelmingly is not possible. This is a point I want to bring out in today's class. Supposing you love a sweet. As an example, so here is a man, he loves a woman. Here is a man, he loves a sweet. Here is a man, he loves music, or a book, or a painting, whatever it is. When a person loves something very deeply, or even superficially, but as an example, very deeply, what is it exactly he is loving? Is he loving the object? What is he loving? Ananda, that is expressed through that Vishaya. That is why in Vedanta, we use two important words, Bimba and Pratibimba. So supposing you are in the room, there are 10 mirrors. How many of you are you are there? How many? Only one. How many reflections are there?
10.
10 reflections. You are called Bimba, means original object. Pratibimba means what? Reflected reflections of whatever is. So in this example, reflections of you. 10 reflections of you. But in all the 10 reflections, who is being reflected?
The bimba.
So what is this analogy for? Every sense object is like a mirror. And who is in front of every sense object? In a way of speaking, it's human language. It's only Atman. The Atman is being reflected in every being. How is it reflected? One definition of Atman is Sat, Chit and Ananda. In this example, here is a man who loves a sweet. So why does he love this sweet? And when he says, I love this sweet, what does he exactly love? So what is the first thing? Here is Sat. Here is an object, Sat. That object representing the Sat, that Sat is a reflection. That's an important point. Sat is a reflection. Why do I say reflection? Well, supposing you are here, 10 mirrors are there. How many reflections will be there?
10.
Suppose one mirror is broken. How many reflections will be there?
None.
Now, here is an important point. When there are 10 mirrors, you see how many reflections?
10.
When there are 9 mirrors, how many reflections you see?
9.
You are not seeing the 10th reflection. Is it because there is no reflection or because there is no medium of reflection? The moment you bring another mirror, the reflections go on increasing. So what happens if one sense object disappears? You don't see the Sat. Do you get the point? That is not because the Sat is dead with that object, because that it works like a mirror, that mirror is absent. Do you get the point? Our mistake is, with the death of absence of any sense object, we think that that object Sat or existence is also gone. It is not gone. It is not available because it is not able to reflect. But that is available in other objects, other mirrors. What is the point here? Here is a mirror and I am able to see my reflection there. That reflection of mine, the existence of the reflection of mine in that mirror, that existence of the reflection belongs to me or to the mirror. Reflection belongs to me. Because of me the reflection is there. The mirror is only the medium. But the medium is not there. You don't see the reflection, but that doesn't mean the sati is gone. That is the mistake we committed. Here is a person, and I have relationship with that person, mother, father, whatever, and dead. So that person's existence also we think has become absent. But the Vedanta tells us, no, you can see that existence in a table, in another person, in another object, wherever there is one single object, you will see it. Suppose there is no object at all, you are there. So if you say, I am there, are you admitting existence or not?
Yes.
Now what is the point I am making? When this person says, I love this sweet, and what does he mean, I love this sweet? What is the first thing? Existence. And whose existence? Atman's existence. Ultimately, Atman's existence means what? My existence. What is the second thing? I get ananda. Does the mirror own the reflection, or it is only a medium for reflecting?
Only medium.
You see? That means the ananda which we mistake an object is giving, does that ananda belong to that object or belongs to Atman?
It belongs to Atman.
Ah, but what is our problem?
We think that it is in the object.
We think that that sweet contains the ananda. There is one objection against it. If anything contains its as its nature, then it should always give happiness. Does a sweet give happiness all the time?
No.
Does any object in this world give happiness all the time? You see the point. All the time, no object gives. Only under peculiar and for a short time, is sweet. How much time does it give happiness? Until your hunger or desire has disappeared, isn't it? The moment it has disappeared, you will not get, even if the sweet is there. Overwhelming sweet is there. But even then, it has to fulfill lot of conditions. Suppose suddenly you find a fly. Suddenly, you find a fly in that sweet. Or a cockroach. In halwa. Not only you will not get happiness, whatever has gone inside, that also you feel like throwing it up, isn't it? That ananda is a reflection of the Atman under the right conditions, when the experiencer and the object of experience are under the right conditions, only then that object reflects. What does it reflect?
Ananda.
That ananda belongs to the object or to Atman?
Atman.
Ultimately, it belongs to me only. Now, most important point. I know it is a little bit tough, but what is the third quality we have discussed about Sat, we have discussed about Ananda. We did not discuss about Chit. When you see the mirror, you are aware there is a mirror. You are aware that there is a reflection. So in this example, suppose you are standing in front of a mirror. What is the purpose? You want to make up your face. You want to find out whether there are any spots or where to put the bottu, etc. You are looking at what? In order to be able to put the bottu, you have to look at your face, or you are looking at the mirror?
Mirror.
At the mirror. But where are you putting the bottu? Are you putting the bottu there, or are you putting here? To one's own self. This is the important point. I am here. The object is here. I love this object. I love this because it gives me happiness. That it gives me happiness. That's why I love this object. That awareness, if you don't have, it is like putting a nice sweet into the mouth of a sleeping person or unconscious person. Does it make any difference? A surgeon is put anesthesia and cutting this person's, throat or whatever, a leg or throat. And suppose he says, oh my dear, after putting anesthesia, my man, I know that you love sweet, I'll put one rasagulla into your face. Does it make any difference to the person? Why? But under other circumstances, when the person is totally aware of that and he is hungry, all conditions fulfilled, the moment he says, oh, this will give me happiness, the moment he puts that one, he is fulfilling his own prophecy. This will give me happiness, this has given me happiness. That is called chit. This chit belongs to the mirror or to the person?
To the person.
Now at least you know, the Sat, Chit and Ananda, they don't belong to any object. But every object can act like a mirror. Okay, I will come to that point later on. Anyway, this is the condition that is there. So, in the case of great people like say Ramakrishna, they could love equally. That is the important point. We also love. What is the problem? Their love is very intense, our love is very small quantity. Our love is unequal. You know, we love some people more, some objects more, some less. We hate even some people. Whereas in their case, the word hatred doesn't arise. It's very important point. The word in their dictionary, there is no word called hatred. Why, you know? If there is hatred, their love will be limited or unlimited?
Limited.
It will be confined only that object which they gives them joy, security, etc. That object they feel overwhelmingly, I love. Whereas, they can hate objects which they give them the opposite effect. In under such circumstances, is it possible to love equally every object, everybody? No question of perhaps.
No, for us.
For us, that whatever, if you want to understand about us, whatever we understand about Sri Ramakrishna, just take the opposite. Easiest way of understanding what is our condition. And all this depends upon only one word, jnana and ajnana. So they are absolutely aware there is something beyond the body-mind complex. And there is no difference. It is only those who have that knowledge, they could love equally everybody. This is what Bhagavad Gita, name dveshyosti na priyaha. I do not have people whom I hate. I do not have people whom I love. Samoham sarvabhuteshu name dveshyosti na priyaha. E bhajanti tu mam bhaktiya. Those who worship me, I am near to them, they are also near to me. It's very interesting psychologically, you know. You are sitting there, I am sitting here. So we can be nearer to each other two ways. Either I go nearer to you or you come nearer to me. You see the point? E bhajanti tu mam bhaktya. Those who worship me with devotion. I am very near to them and they are very near to me. That means what? What is worship? Coming near. And only idea we have to understand. God is not somebody looking, sitting like you. God is everywhere. This is a point of view from the point of knowledge, not from point of time space. God is right here. Right here means He is everything. The more we know, the nearer we are. The less we know, as if we are furthest from Him. Taddure tadvantike tadantarasya sarvasya tadu sarvasyasya bahyataha tadejati tarnayati. It moves, it doesn't move. Taddure tadvantike. It is very far. Atman is very far. Very, very near. It is there inside everybody. Atman is also outside everybody. How can these opposite qualities abide in the same being? It is possible only when there are no opposite qualities, but whatever is nothing but one. That is the idea. The difference here, inside, outside, near and far, and inside and outside, moves and doesn't move, all these are movements in knowledge, not physical movements at all. Sri Ramakrishna had that overwhelming knowledge, and that is why he was able to love. And that is the reason why detachment, we are talking about detachment. What is detachment? Nobody can take away from me. can anybody take away anything from me? From worldly point of view, yes. From spiritual point of view, no. Let us briefly discuss. Supposing, you know, I have money. They can take away money because it is a physical object. But if you look at that money, you can look at the money from two points. As an object, which is called money. As God, who is everywhere. If we look at the object as an object, then it can be with me, it can be somebody else, it could be near, it could be far. But if it is looked upon as nothing but Sat, Chit and Ananda, then who can take it away from me? Because God cannot be taken away from me. That is one thing, nobody can take it away from me. Sri Ramakrishna, even at that time, he used to go into ecstasies. He had lot of visions of God. Not once, many times. We don't know how many times, because he never described. And visions cannot be understood unless you express that I had a vision. Oh. How will you know whether I have a vision or not? Sometimes he described a little bit of it during the course of his talk with his devotees. Oh. I had this vision, so we know. Does that mean to say that he had only those visions and no other visions? He had so many visions. Just as an example, as he was telling to somebody, in those days when I was doing sadhana, he used a slang expression. You know what? Visions used to come like diarrhea. 24 hours, you know. How many visions I had? Interesting point is, how many visions one can have? Okay, how many visions can a person have?
Innumerable, or one.
Innumerable, yes, that is right. You know why? Because if it is Brahman, how many visions?
One.
Only one. But if it is Shakti, you can see as Rama, Krishna, and even Rama. Tumaki chalata Rama Chandra, Bhajata Paijaniya. This is one vision. And Dhanurbhana, like that. That is another type of vision. Like Mukundamala. Kulasekhar Advar is describing, you know. You all heard it. These are all old times lectures. Kulasekhar Advar, he composed. He was one of the 12 Alvars, one of the greatest Vaishnava saints. He composed. It is called Krishna Karnamritam. Sri Krishna Karnamritam. Wonderful Sanskrit, like Gita Govinda, equivalent to Gita Govinda. Now, one of the poems is describing Sri Krishna's babyhood. Baby means he was a small child. He wants to hear a story at night. His mom, tell me a story. One incident, you remember? Mom, I want to drink milk. Just now he drank milk. 2 minutes back. He wants to drink again. Mother said, no, you already had your drink. You will not have now. So when am I going to have? Very innocently was asking. Only at night. Mom, what is night? This night is when you cannot see anything. Immediately he closed. Mom, I can't see anything. It is dark. Please give me milk. And then, Mom, tell me a story. Then she started. Ramayana. Because Krishna's avatara was subsequent to Rama avatara. He says, Dasharatho nama. Raja Babhuva, there was a king called Dasharatha. And he had a son called Rama. And this Rama was, and he was telling, then what happened? Then, Saidich. So what happened? And he was sent to forest along with his wife Sita. And then what happened? One Asura called Ravanasura came and kidnapped Sita. He should have said, then what happened? No. Hey, ha Lakshmana. Kodhanu, kodhanu, kodhanu ho. Hey Lakshmana, bring my bow. My Sita is being kidnapped. After hearing his mother saying, he was remembering his old incarnation. And he was, instead of saying Sai, immediately he said, hey Lakshmana, where is my bow and arrow? Where is Lakshmana? He has gone to sleep. This is called evocative language. We spoke about language during Jnana Yoga. It's called evocative language. It's a few words, but it evocates something like that. So, what is the point here? Ramakrishna, even at that time, had innumerable visions. So, you can see Sri Krishna as baby Krishna, as companion of the Gopas, as companion of the Gopis, as Gita Krishna. You can have any idea of Krishna according to your nature. All these visions one can have. all these visions. Once Sri Ramakrishna was in Balaram Babu's house, Balaram Babu knew about Gopal Irma. He sent news for her that you please come. And she came. The moment she was approaching, immediately he became like a Gopala, like this. Nadu Gopal, like that. Then Gopala Irma came, and then devotees understood. Before even Gopala's Ma came, the moment she came near, he assumed this form, because they did not know when she is going to enter. Then you see devotees understood, some great devotee of Gopala is about to enter, and that's why automatically he assumed this form. Anyway, she came and passed some caustic remarks. What is this stiff figure of Gopala? I don't like this Gopala. But the point is, he could assume any form. So Sri Ramakrishna has plenty of visions, but we don't know how many visions he had. But what is the point? When a person was having this kind of visions, what would be the state of his mind? What do you think? When after this vision, when Sri Ramakrishna looked at anybody, any object, what do you think he would be looking at?
Whatever vision he had.
No, no, God. God, the idea of God, that is important. He could see the God, the divinity behind everybody, and that is the secret of both his Viveka and his Vairagya and his overwhelming love for all and his detachment. What is detachment? I do not lose anything. That is called detachment. He could be very happy. Detachment brings happiness. How could detachment bring happiness? Only one condition. And that condition is, really, I have not lost anything. That is the idea. Such beautiful ideas are coming after reading, you know, Ramakrishna, the great master. Only in this light, you could see how he loved the villagers. In this light, you could see how he was going to love his disciples, and both monastic and householders, and also everybody. One last question. Could Sri Ramakrishna hate anybody? No. Could Sri Ramakrishna hate God?
No.
But one thing is there. When the cover is so thick that the manifestation of God is less in somebody, then he would not be attracted in that incarnation towards that person, because neither that person derives any happiness or any benefit, nor Sri Ramakrishna derives any benefit from that person. Main mission is to help people. That's why he bestowed his grace upon all people, but especially those people who are in a condition to receive his help and become better. With this background, then we can understand his relationships. And why I am taking such a long time? What is our bondage?
Body.
We say, no, it is not body, it is not mind. It is the relationship we cherish towards any object. What is your relationship with your parents, with your sisters and brothers and husband and wife and children? They let all of them be there. They are not obstruction. Where is the problem? It is relationship. It is the relationship. That is what we need to change. Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti.